got that one. But it came from the person who
was
the
air.
It was hot.
Yeah.
Is it time?
Yeah.
That the Lord has.
Two minutes after.
Okay, then tell me. When we start, Joe.
Okay.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
You know, today is a brand new day. And you get to choose how you want this day to go. Do you want it to go for Jesus, or do you want to just go south?
No. Because
you know, you get to choose by your attitude and your actions. You get to choose what kind of day you're going to have. Even if everybody tries to mess it up, remember, you get to choose how you respond.
Right.
Because you know, we have we have more power with Jesus in our hearts than we realize. That we can overcome obstacles. We can overcome discouragement because we have the power within us. If you have Jesus in your heart, then you have the fruits of the Spirit. You need to let them shine. Let that love, joy, peace come out. Because the whole world needs to see that, because that describes our Jesus. So please take this day and make it something that is just amazing for you. So we're going to sing some great songs because we get to sing them to our Savior. And when we sing these, it's more than words. It's what we say, and we need to make sure we understand and we know what we're saying. And sing them with a grateful and a joyful heart. So let's stand, and let's sing these songs, and let's own them.
We need your hymn book this morning. It's hymn number 600, number 61. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Number 61.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us,
for we
need thy tender care. In thy blessed pastures,
feed us,
for our use that foes prepare. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us thine, we are. Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us thine, we are. We are thine, do thou befriend us, be the guardian of our way. Keep thy flock from sin, defend us, seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, us when we pray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear us when we pray. Thou hast promised to receive us, poor and sinful though we be. Thou hast mercy to grace to cleanse and bound to free. Blessed Jesus.
Hymn number 413, Faith is the Victory that Overcomes the World.
Encamped along the hills of fight, ye Christian soldiers rise, and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the falling bells below, let all our strength be hurled. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. His banner over us is love. Was for the word of God. We tread the road the saints above with shouts of triumph trod. Our faith may light the world with breath swept over every field.
The faith
by which they conquered death is still our shining shield. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
To him
who overcomes the world, our kingdom shall begin. Before the angels he shall know his name confessed again. Then onward from the hills of light, our hearts with love aflame,
will vanquish all the
Jesus' conquering name. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
Glory.
Amen. All right, you have your Bibles with you. We'll take them and hold them up and let's make this declaration. Are you ready? For memory, this is my Bible, God's holy word. It's given to teach me truth, to reprove me of sin, to correct me when I'm wrong, and instruct me in what is right. It's a lamp unto my daily walk, and a light unto my eternal path. And if I hide his words in my heart, then I will not sin against God. This is my Bible, and it can change my life today. Amen? Amen. Have a seat. Believe it or not, we are live. In our second service, you're not used to that. This little thing here is my phone shooting out a signal. We couldn't get it on the first service. Hopefully we're going to make it on the second service and to get it out so folks can have a service with us. And we're glad to have you with us. It's going to be a little different because we're going to have children's time and you won't see me during that time. So that'll just be the way it is. But we're going to have a good time. We had a good week this week. It's been a great week. Things are coming up. Make sure and look in your bulletin. There's a couple of things in there you need to see, and I hope that you'll do what you can to be available. First of all, let me just say this, that next Friday, listen to the time, at 10:30 in the morning, the place is at the
Brookside
Funeral Home in Houston, Dennis Hardy Funeral, 10:30 at Brookside in Houston on Friday. Saturday, change gears, pay attention. Saturday is our memorial service for Tanya Tullis. We'll be at 2:00 here at the church. And we, the church, are providing desserts for after the service.
So
What are we providing?
Desserts.
Desserts. So I hope that you'll help us. The more there are, I think that more we show the families that we really love them. So please, if you can't come to the funeral, at least drop a dessert off, okay? And it's not that hard to do. And there will be somebody here at noon to receive those desserts. And so just drop them off here for the dessert time, okay? Appreciate you doing that. on the 14th, that's a Sunday week, 2 weeks from today, on Sunday night, we are going to do a spring fling. This is to replace the Valentine banquet. And we're going to be having a banquet that evening during church time, right, or instead of church time, at 6:30. And it's a fundraiser to raise money for Operation Christmas Child. If you haven't, if you've bought tickets to the Valentine banquet, that's going to be good for this banquet. But if you haven't bought your ticket, make sure and see Jasmine and get your ticket so that you can come. It'll be a lot of fun. It'll be a fun evening for us as a church. It'll be a very close time. I think we've got some things planned. They'll be very, very special. And I hope that you make plans to be here for that.
Free child care.
Say what?
We have free child care.
Free child care that night. Free child care that night. So you ought to come. All right. WOM meets the
11th.
So WOM, make sure that you're aware of that and come and help as they... They're going to do Easter baskets, right?
Yes, sir.
Doing Easter baskets for the Easter egg hunt. So we've got a lot of things going. All right, so that's enough information. You've already quit listening to that, so we'll just go on. We don't need to talk any more about those. But I hope that you'll be back tonight at 6:30. I'm going to be preaching out of the book of Exodus again, chapters 35. Believe it or not, probably through 37.
Wow.
It'd be worth you coming just to see if I can do it. You know what I'm saying? It'd be worth
it. It's always worth coming. Always worth coming.
Yes, it's always worth coming. So, all right. All right, I think that's it. Let's bring the kids down and see what's in the surprise box. All right. Josette has brought me a surprise box. And we're going to have to use a little pair of the surprise box. That's okay. That happens sometimes. Glad you're here. Here we are, all girls except Levi. Hey, Levi, join us, buddy. Give me five, amen. Boys rule, girls rule.
Better watch out.
$100 Wow, it's play money though, isn't it? It's not real money, but it's play money. $100 bill in there. Yeah. It looks kind of rich, doesn't it? Yeah, you probably remember that show to you. You know, some things look real and they're not. You know, Satan has a way of making things look better than they are. He'll make you think that it's better. He'll say, you know, that's not as bad as preacher says it was, or the Bible says it is. And so old smutty face, that's what I call him, old smutty face, old devil. He loves to try to make things look better than they are. But you know what would happen if you were to take this and try to cash it? They put you in jail. Did you know that? Because it's counterfeit. This probably would be considered counterfeit. If it was closely enough, it could be counterfeit. And that would be illegal. And they put you in jail for that. And let me just tell you something. Satan will try to get you to do things, and he'll say, oh, it's not that bad. It's not that bad. It's not that bad. Let me tell you something. It's just like trying to cash this $100 bill. It'll be a lot worse than you think it is when it's all done, because Satan wants to destroy you. He hates you. You know why he hates you? Do you know why Satan hates you? Because God loves you.
That's right.
And Satan, what is it, Lois? Satan hates everything that God loves. So Satan hates you. God loves you. And that's a great thing. He's in our hearts.
All right.
Amen. Well, I tell you what, let's have a word of prayer, and then we're going to dismiss the children's church. Father, Lord, I thank you for these little ones. I pray, God, that you bless them. Help them, Father, always to choose what you want, not what Satan wants. And Lord, if they're not saved yet, I pray, Lord, maybe something today will be said, and they'll recognize their need for a Savior. And for those that are saved, Lord, I pray they'll continue to grow in Christ. Amen. And I know that this is the second service, and so
This is 600. This is good. So let's see who hasn't had a box in a long, long time. Ryan had it.
Ryan hasn't had it.
She's never had it.
Yes, she did. Her first week.
Oh, that's first week. I tell you what, I gave you this set, and I'm gonna send it home with you. And will you tell Brother Jim up there? Tell him he needs to fix this for me, okay? Look at him up there. Yes, he will do that. He'll fix it for me. Okay. All right, now look, we have children's church for the little guys. The older ones all need to stay here. This is the last Sunday of the month, and the last Sunday is the day that the older children, older ones stay in here. Just the young ones, we have children's church, and that is ages?
Kindergarten and down.
Kindergarten and younger. If you're in kindergarten or younger, if you're in first grade or above, I want you to find a place to sit, and I want you to listen, okay? All right, off you go. Here we go. All right, good deal.
Hymn number 524. Number 524. Let's stand together as we sing. Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known.
Join in a song of sweet accord. Join in a song of sweet accord.
And thus around the throne,
and thus around the throne,
we're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion.
Hillsides
Well, it's good to see all of you. And y'all heard about Brother Jim Bryce, I guess. I want to tell you, Pat called me and told me that he's doing better. She said she's so disappointed. They had planned to come to church this Sunday. I would love to have Brother Jim in church on Sunday. Amen. I love his amens. And she said, Brother Jim, would you believe it's a year since we've been in church? I said, yes, I believe that. And we have missed you. And it's a long time, but they had gotten their vaccinations and they felt comfortable and they were planning to be here on Sunday today. And then Brother Jim had a little mishap yesterday, but he's doing better and hopefully he'll be home. I don't know if he's home from the hospital yet, but hopefully soon. And maybe next week he and Pat will be here and Brother Jim will sit there and give me one of them, amen, amen. He gave me an amen. I love it. Well, if you have your Bibles, if you will, take them out. Let's go to Romans chapter 12. Again, we're going to finish chapter 12 today. As I get into this, you'll see where it could have been. Probably another month I could have taken and broken it down some more. But I really feel like the way I've got it broken down really helps us understand it. Romans chapter 12 is the practical side of the book. It's the he's finished the first 11 chapters, which were doctrinal. Then he comes to chapter 12 and he begins by addressing how to live the victorious Christian life. And it's an amazing thing. Let's have a word of prayer and let me get started. Excuse me. Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning for your word. I thank you, God, that you have given us a formula. You've given us an outline. You've given us your word, a promise of how we can live as victorious Christians. And I pray this morning as we step off into these texts, these words, these sentences, Lord, that there'll be more than that, that we'll understand them to be direct from you, the things we need to hear. I thank you. I love you that you give us your word, and I thank you that this morning we have opportunity to look into your word and see what you have for us. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So chapter 12, he begins by establishing for us the formula for the Christian, victorious Christian life. And that begins with us being a living sacrifice. That's where it's got to start. And it's interesting as we step through this book how he builds on that. That's where it starts. We have to be this living sacrifice. And like I've said, as Christians, that's a difficult thing. Because as a living sacrifice, we find that we get off the altar way too easy. You'll come to church and you'll hear a message and it'll stir your heart. And you may give yourself again to a commitment to Christ. And you literally get on that altar and say, Lord, I sacrifice myself. I want to be that living sacrifice. But by the time you get to the back door, one leg is already off the altar. And by the time you reach the car, you're no longer even in that frame of mind. But Paul says if we're going to live the victorious Christian life, it will be because we've decided that we will be that living sacrifice. We're then continually, as he says, we are transformed. We're being transformed from that person who solely is attached to the world and all of its influence to being set free to live in harmony with all the others as we serve the Lord together. It's a transformation that takes place at salvation, and it begins to grow even further as we yield ourselves to be that living sacrifice, because as we do that, we become detached from the world. The problem we have in the church, the problem we have as individual Christians, is the world has such a strong attraction that we allow it to interfere with what God wants to do. But when we finally move to that place of being a living sacrifice, we detach from the world. We say, no longer will I allow the world to dictate to me how to live. I only will live for Jesus Christ. And as we begin to be transformed into becoming what God wants us to, and God puts us in positions in the body of Christ, he also introduces us to the spiritual gifts. We went through those back a few weeks ago, that are listed there in Romans chapter 12. And each one of you are given a spiritual gift, at least one, maybe more. As God places you in the body, he gives you a spiritual gift that will help you in fulfilling the purpose that God has for you in the body of Christ. Then there's a realization as you begin to use those gifts that all of a sudden it's not all about you anymore. But we're tied together. We are become a part of a whole. We are a part of the body of Christ functioning together and accomplishing his will for the church. And all of this brings about the change in our lives to be more in tune with the Spirit of God and to each other. And that's where Paul leads us. It started last week and we finished this week. Paul leads us in a series of changes that will be taking control of our lives as we learn to live as a living sacrifice. Last week, we looked at there would be genuine love. There'd be genuine goodness, humility, genuine service for the Lord. In that, there'd be a genuine piety, a reverence about what God is doing in our lives. And finally, a genuine care for one another. This morning, though, he takes us to a few more areas that will be changed as we begin to live as a living sacrifice. Let's look now at Romans chapter 12, verses 14 through 21, and you will see what I'm talking about. It's just a list, bang, 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 bang. But watch as we put it together. He says, bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Recompense no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. And if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome evil, but overcome evil with good. Just a list, one after another. And you can see how very easily, as a pastor, I could take that and pull it apart, and we could spend a week on each one of those. But we're not going to do that. I feel like we need to move. And I feel like that we need to look at this as a whole. And so I put it together so we can look at this. First of all, he begins in verse 14, teaching us how to handle offense. Offense. There's a lot of that going on today, isn't there? I love what Facebook had on it the other day. It said, I can't believe I'm living in a world where somebody's become so offended that now we're having to rename a plastic potato head because of his gender. How ridiculous is that? Because somebody got offended. They've gotten offended over everything, haven't they? It's gotten to be just plumb ridiculous, the offense that people are carrying around. So I think it's good. We're in a good spot. Paul is going to teach us, the Lord is going to teach us through his word, how to handle offense. What do you do when somebody offends you? Now I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to find that the way God says to deal with it is going to be exactly opposite of probably the way you've learned. But what a wonderful thing when we do it God's way instead of the world's way. First of all, he says, bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. You know, us Texans, we've got this figured out, don't we? Bless your heart. Bless your... They come up and persecute us and go, bless your heart. Now, if we meant it, that'd be great, because that'd be exactly what God is saying. You know, maybe we could try it with a little more empathy and a little more feeling to it. You know, bless your heart. I'm so sorry I've offended you in that. But understand, we need to move past that. So we don't allow people to offend us. We bless them. We do just the opposite of what we might want to do. And notice this, it says, bless them and do what? Curse not. Haven't you found that it's easy to want to maybe give them a little piece of your mind when they've offended you in some way? I find people do that a lot nowadays. As Christians, we have opportunity to be something different. You know, God's called us to be the light in the world, a light in darkness. I think one of the greatest places we can demonstrate light is the way we respond to people in their negativity, the way they offend. I couldn't help but go back to Matthew chapter 5, because there at the end of the Beatitudes, the Lord gives some real instruction about this. I feel like I want to share with you a little bit more other than just bless them. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 11 and 12, he says, blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely. Did you hear what he said? He said, blessed are you. Blessed are you. Whenever we're reviled, for my sake, he says. Then he says this, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which are before you. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad when one would persecute you, when somebody would want to offend you. Find a way to turn the circumstance away from something negative and turn it to something positive. And then Matthew 5:23 gives an illustration of how we need to make things right quickly. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 23, it says, therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. You know, when people read that, I think they read it without really listening to what it says. It doesn't say that if you've offended somebody, you go to them and get it fixed. We know that's something you ought to do. But here it says, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember that somebody else has something against you, go to them. You know why? Because God puts a high priority on our relationships in the church. We don't need any kind of disruption, any kind of disunity, any kind of backbiting, bitterness, talking, gossip. We don't need that in the church. We don't need that at all. And if we know somebody has something against us, We need to go to them and try to get it fixed. And then he says in Matthew 5:43, the Lord really goes into an important passage about how to deal with your enemies. He says, you have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. That's the way we were brought up, maybe. But I say, Jesus says, but I say unto you, Lord, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Isn't that interesting? Somebody persecutes you. Somebody despitefully uses you. Somebody takes advantage of you. The Lord says, what should you do? Well, you should bless them. You should do good to them and pray for them. That's what he says. That's a little hard sometimes. So, preacher, wait a minute. You know, somebody does that to me. I'm telling you what. I'm not sure I can pray for them. Well, the Lord says that's what you're supposed to do. You see, if you want to live like the world does and have relationships like the world does, then go ahead. But if you want to have relationships like God wants us to have, let's do it God's way. Then he says, verse 45, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good. Descendeth rain on the just and the unjust. God wants you to be like him. He loves everybody. He cares about everybody. Listen, if you had as many people curse your name as he has every day, you'd have a hard time loving them. But God does. He loves them. He cares about them. Verse 46, for if you love them which love you, what reward have you? That's easy, isn't it? I love my wife and she loves me back. That's easy love, isn't it? But if she were my enemy, it's a little more difficult. But the Lord says, but this is what you ought to do. He says, if you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans do so? Even the sinners do that? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect, he says. We ought to have a love for our enemy. Then back to our text, Romans chapter 12, verse 15. Be compassionate. Rejoice with them that rejoice and weep with them that weep. Rejoice with them that rejoice. Let me ask you a question. Can you find that joy when someone else is being blessed and you're being overlooked? Sometimes it's a little difficult, isn't it? It's hard to say, well, praise the Lord. I'm so glad God's given you all of that. When you're sitting there going, you know, I could have used that. You know, joy ought to be the attitude of every born-again believer. Joy. Not happiness. I'm not talking about that flippant, you know. I'm talking about deep joy. I'm talking about there ought to be a peace about you, a joy about you that's real. A true living sacrifice can do this. It should not be a matter if it's about you. It's a matter that it's about one of your brothers or sisters. Now, here's the problem with that. How many of you were raised with more than one sibling? All of us have. I had three brothers. I was not the oldest and I was not the youngest. So, you know, if you're not the youngest and you're not the oldest, you're the one that gets picked on a lot.
That's
right. So I know a little bit about that. As siblings, you know what they call that? And I know with my three children, sibling rivalry, right? You're familiar with that? My three children get in the back seat of the car, sibling rivalry. You know why? Because no one wants to sit in the middle, right? He's touching me. She's touching me. She's leaning on me. Get her off of me. Dad, Mom. Sibling rivalry. Now listen to what I'm about to tell you. Very important. In the household of God, in the family of God, there should be no sibling rivalry. Amen? We're different than humans, than just the human nature of sibling rivalry. We go beyond that. We are to live as his children, and we're not to be rival. We ought not to be trying to hurt each other or get above the other one or worry about fairness. We're just excited over what happens in another person's life. And then it says, weep with them that weep. Can you show true empathy when a brother or sister is hurting? And I don't mean to put a little emoji on the Facebook page. You know, I care about you. There ought to be a little bit more than that. I do use emojis. But I think there ought to be more than that. Someone calls and said, man, I'm hurting and I need some prayer. How about right then, in that moment, before you say anything else, take your shoes off and imagine putting their shoes on and living through what they're living through before you even speak. Just stop. And that's empathy. It's allowing yourself to feel what they feel, to know how they hurt. Pat Bryce called the other night. Immediately when I saw it was Jim Bryce, I knew something might have happened. And it's picked up and Pat's weeping. Before I could say anything, I took my shoes off. And I put her shoes on so I could feel what she was feeling. Her husband of 60-something years, isn't it? I think they've been married 60 years. Was in the hospital and she couldn't even go in with him. She didn't know what was wrong. She'd walk back in the room and there he was slumped down in a chair and she couldn't get him to respond. Can you imagine? Before I could speak, I had to let myself feel what she felt. Tears welled up my eyes as I began to answer her and say that I'd pray for her. Knowing that she was hurting. We've got to have that kind. Weep with those who weep. If a person is in a true relationship, we will find fellowship in suffering. We will join with them. Verse 16 of Romans 12. Be of the same mind, one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to man of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. I list this as having the right attitude. Three things. Number one, strive for singleness of mind. Well, how do I do that? Be of the same mind, one toward another, it says. The easiest way to do this is if we all have the mind of Christ. If we just have the mind of Christ, it's not about you thinking like I think. It's about you thinking like Jesus think and me thinking like Jesus think. And we find that singleness of mind. We are together in this. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 8, Paul says this, let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Now that's kind of an interesting statement. He says Jesus is God. But when it came to him becoming human, he took off his glory robe and he put on his earthly human robe. And by doing that, he humbled himself. He made himself conformable. It says here, he says, and he made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in the fashion of man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. When Jesus took on his humanity, do you realize what he did? He let his creation take care of him. Mary and Joseph were responsible to change his diaper. The creator of the universe, can you imagine? But that's what God did. And Jesus thought it not robbery to be equal. He didn't have to be equal with God at that moment because he was coming to pay the price for our sin. And he understood the importance of what he was called upon to do. And he did that just for us. Amen. Secondly, we find that this mind, we have the same mind, but then also we are to love as God loves. Mind not to high things, but condescend to men of low estate. The Message is a little paraphrased Bible that sometimes I like to open and see what it says. And listen to what it says. This is the text. Don't be stuck up. Make friends with nobodies. Make friends with those that are difficult to befriend. Guard yourself from your bigotries. You say, I don't have any bigotries. Oh, yes, you do. We all do. We don't like them, but we have them. And they pop up ever so often, you know. They pop up. They show up. We don't like them. We say, I don't really want that to be a part of my life. But it is. So now I've got to deal with it. Guard yourself from those bigotries. Did you know that every person in this room, I don't care what color you are, I don't care where you came from, I don't care how old or young you are, did you know what will happen if you cut your finger? You'll bleed, right? What color is your blood? Do you know that that's the same with every person? You bleed red. And we want to judge the outside? How ridiculous for us to do that. for us to do that. We are made by God, and we are created to be the recipient of His love. Every person, doesn't matter who they are, every person is one that Jesus would die for. In fact, our love for each other should be generated from the love that God has for us. Just like I told the children this morning, God loves them. Every little child that was around me, Jesus Christ would die for. Did. That person that's the hardest person for you to love, I'm talking about that person that just drives you crazy mad because of the way they act or don't act or what they respond to, Jesus Christ died for him or her. Love as God loves. Having the right attitude, strive with singleness of mind, love as God loves, and thirdly, guard your ego. Be not wise in your own conceits, he says. Do not mind not those high things. Be not wise in your own conceits. You know what that means? It says don't be a know-it-all. Don't be a know-it-all. You remember Cliff Clavin? I mean, many of you probably do. Some of you don't. But Cliff Clavin was Cheers. He was the postman. And it didn't matter what you're talking about. He knew something about it. And usually more than you did. You remember how irritating that is with people? To think that you know more than they do. The Bible says, do not be a know-it-all. In fact, Proverbs 3:7 says this, be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. And then verse 17 of our text says, recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. Now we've already dealt with this in somewhat, but let me just give this. This is responding not to offense, but responding to evil. Just evil. First of all, he says, recompense to no man evil for evil. We are not to retaliate. No retaliation. Zero. Zilch. See, the world would say, oh yes, you do. You better stand up. And I say you can stand up, but you don't have to retaliate. Matthew chapter 5, verse 38 says this. Have you not heard that it's been said, an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth? That's what we've been taught. But Jesus said unto you that you resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. Dr. McGee had a real interesting illustration about that. A young man came into him and he had two black eyes. Preacher said, what happened? He said, man, I don't know what happened. This guy, he walked up to me and he just gave me a punch on the face, like to knock me down. He said, well, what'd you do? He said, I remember that verse about turning the other cheek. So I just turned the other cheek, thinking that he would leave me alone. But instead, he literally locked me out, hit me in the other cheek. Preacher said, well, what'd you do then? He said, I got up and beat the stuffings out of him. He said, well, what happened to turning the other cheek? He said, I did. He said, the Bible says the right cheek, the left cheek, but then after that, it doesn't tell me what to do. So I just took it on myself. I was supposed to beat the stuffings out of him. My preacher said one time, this is kind of funny. He said, if somebody hits you on the right cheek, he said, you turn the left cheek as you bring an uppercut with your left. No, that's not right. That's not what he's teaching here. He's talking about how we're to respond to evil. Turn the other cheek. In fact, Matthew 5:40 says this, and if a man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, tell him about thy cloak also. A man comes and he's in some way trying to take advantage of you, and he brings you to the courts and he says, I'm going to take what you've got. I'm going to take your coat. He says, go ahead and just give him your shirt too. He said, here, you want this so bad? Here, take this too. And then Matthew 5:41 says, whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him too. Go the extra mile. And this is all about how to deal with evil. Someone who's being evil, someone that's trying to use you or abuse you, if they ask you to go a mile, go 2 miles with them. Deal with them in integrity. He says, provide things honest in the sight of all men. You know, nothing goes further than being truthful and honest in all your dealings. Integrity. Integrity in the believer is so important. We try to hide from God, which is ridiculous. And then we think we can hide from others. We can't hide. Why not just be honest? Why not just be truthful? I found that it's a lot better to be honest with people and deal with the issue at hand than it is to be dishonest, thinking in some way I'm protecting them and it'd be blowback on me. You know what I'm talking about? It happens all the time. I promise you. If you ever try to protect somebody by not being honest with them, it's going to get blown back on you. It'll be right up your face before you turn around. The best thing is just be honest. You say, but what if it's hurtful? Deal with the hurt. Deal with the hurt. Allow them to experience what they need to experience and then be there to comfort them and bring them through it. Even when someone else is being rude or trying to take advantage, just be honest and truthful with them. And then Romans 12:18, we finish with this. If it be possible. Aren't you glad Paul put that there? You know, this has been some tough stuff. This is some stuff that goes against the grain. And so finally he says, well, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Try. Work at it. Live in peace. And then he tells us, Romans 12:19, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it's written, vengeance is mine, I will repay. Leave vengeance to God. We think that we've got to take vengeance to prove that we're somebody, that in some way we're right and they're wrong. The greatest way to get vengeance on a person is to leave them alone and let God deal with them. I'm going to tell you, God deals with them on a level you can't even touch. You see, the only way I can deal with somebody in vengeance is on the outside. But God deals on the inside. Do the opposite of the world. Excuse me. Romans 12:20. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Do just the opposite of what the world would do. If your enemy comes and he's hungry, you have him over the barrel now, right? You know, he's your enemy and now he's hungry. He's wanting something from you. Hey, go ahead and take advantage of him, right? That's what the world would say. No, God says feed him. Take care of him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. And then listen to what the word says. He said, in so doing what? You heap coals of fire on their head. And that's just exactly what it means. But you need to be careful that that's not the reason behind what you do. You feed and give them to drink because you care for them. Then God will heap coals of fire on their head. That is God doing his work in their life. God hoping and praying that God will open their eyes to the need to be different than they are. And then lastly, chapter 12, verse 21 says, be not overcome evil, but overcome evil with good. Listen to what he says. You have a choice. That's what he says. It's your choice. You can choose to do evil or you can choose to do good. It's your choice. It's just a matter of choice. Just as love is a choice, doing evil is a choice. Doing good is a choice. You've got to make that decision. So let me ask you, are you getting this? When God takes control of your heart, you being the living sacrifice, you then deal with others differently than those that are still in the world. You find as you are living as a living sacrifice, there's something inside of you makes you act differently to those around you. Where the world would seek revenge and retaliation and disruption, God's surrendered child will seek compassion and peace and a sweet spirit. No wonder we are called to be the light in darkness. If we live by this set of attributes, If we live by these things that we've talked about, genuine love, goodness, humility, service, piety, care, handling offense properly, being compassionate, having the right attitude, if we will respond to evil properly, if we'll live in peace, listen, do you realize how much difference it'd make in the world? We would be the lights. Because that's so different than the world is dealing with things. All we have to do is just yield to what God says. That's all. Oh, Brother Jim, you make it sound easy. I'm not telling you it's easy. Good night. I had a situation again yesterday. Can you believe it? 19. Coming up 19. There we are. What's the speed limit? 70 miles an hour. Two people driving side by side, 60 miles an hour. I've got 10 miles to go. This will make up a whole minute if I just would drive my speed limit. I could get there a minute faster. And they want to drive 60 miles an hour? I know you're thinking, I'm going to tell you that I responded properly. I tell you what, let's do. Let's just go to prayer. It's not easy, but we are called to be these people that live like this. And when we do, oh, what a difference it's going to make. What a difference it will make if we will live like this. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you this morning that you've given us such explicit instruction. And Lord, I know that for me, it's a difficult thing to live as a living sacrifice. I can get off that altar as quick as anybody I know. But Lord, I understand there's victory when I stay on the altar. There's victory when I learn to respond to things the way you tell us to respond. I love you. And I pray, Father, that you would help me to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto you, which is my reasonable service. Our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. And first of all, let me just ask you, do you know Jesus? Are you saved today? If you're not saved, wouldn't you like to be saved today? Call upon him. Say, Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I don't deserve heaven. But I know you love me and you died for me. And right now, God, I just call upon you. I ask you to give me that eternal life that you promised. And he'll do that. Dear child of God, the message is really to us. Are you living as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God? Are these attributes we've listed, are these part of your life today? We have a time of invitation. I invite you just to stand right where you are. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. As the girls sing and play, you do what God wants you to do right now.